brought to you by Penguin.
Sexton Blake versus the Master Crooks by Mark Hodder, read by Colin Mace. Baker Street, London. Yesterday, when I rang the doorbell, Sexton Blake had opened the door. Today, an old woman did so. She was short in stature, wide-hipped and white-haired, with a face into which everybody's favourite grandmother appeared to have been incorporated. I adored her at first sight.
"Come in and wipe your feet," she said. "Give me that there brolly. I'll not have it dripping everywhere. I does enough mopping as it is. This here incremental weather plays the merry devil with me floors."
I did as instructed, and she put it in a stand in the corner by the door. Then she took my coat and hung it on a hook.
"He's in his insulting room," she said, "spectating you. So just knock and go in. I'll bring up a pot of coffee."
I went up the stairs and knuckled the first door on the right. A voice called, "Come." Blake was in his armchair. He was wrapped in a red and threadbare, acid-stained dressing gown, just as described in so many of his stories. There were frayed slippers on his feet. As ever, he was smoking. Today, a briar pipe. I always thought, when reading descriptions of him thus disposed, that either his authors had turned him into a Sherlock Holmes knockoff, or Blake himself was indulging in an affectation. Now I could see how wrong I was in either supposition. There was nothing remotely Holmesian or contrived about him. He radiated a strength, command, and grounded authenticity that I couldn't at all associate with Conan Doyle's famous creation. He flicked a finger toward the seat opposite his own. I crossed to it, put down my briefcase, and sat. "Mrs. Bardell," I said. "I just saw Mrs. Bardell."
"Why so surprised?" he drawled. "You know she's my housekeeper."
"Yes, but I feel like I'm dreaming. She even... the malapropisms."
"Insulting room?"
"Yes.
I rather suspect that nowadays she does it on purpose."
He pointed the stem of his pipe at my briefcase. "What do you have for me today?" I bent, drew a binder from the case and handed it to him. "Master Crooks."
"No doubt you found yourself with rather too many to choose from."
I leaned back in the chair and threw up my hands in helpless exasperation. "Way too many, and they all swooped on you at once." True, but I was prepared. I'd been going at it hammer and tongs with the first of them, George Marsden Plummer, since 1908. His schemes demonstrated a degree of ambitious villainy that I hadn't previously encountered, but I knew that, should the right circumstances arise, others like him would emerge. There came a tap at the door. It opened and Mrs. Bardell entered. She was holding a tray on which there was a coffee pot, a couple of cups, a small jug of milk, a pot of cream, and a little bowl of sugar. She crossed to us and placed it on the table beside Blake's chair.
"Great heavens," she said, "ain't it coming down today? But as what my dear sister Mary Ann Clappins always used to say, rain is good for vegetables, and for the animals what eats those vegetables, and for the animals what eats those animals, and for people what eats them all."
"Thank you, Mrs. B," Blake said, "and I think you'll find that your sister was misquoting Samuel Johnson."
"I don't recollect her mentioning no Sam Johnson," she replied, moving back to the door, "let alone disquoting him."
She departed. "She's marvellous," I exclaimed. Blake reached for the coffee pot. "How do you like it?" "Dash of milk, no sugar." He poured, passed me a cup, then added three spoonfuls of sugar and one of cream to his own. Were Sexton Blake like other men, I thought, the Master Crooks needn't have plotted to kill him. His lifestyle choices would have done the job for them. But, of course, Sexton Blake wasn't like other men. "The Great War," he said. I frowned. I'd lost the thread. "It presented exactly the circumstances required. Opportunities for extravagant criminal schemes abounded amid the chaos. Also, the long-established structure of British society began to crumble. Men, psychologically damaged by their experiences at the front, returned home to a land that was suddenly unfamiliar to them. People were mentally and physically displaced. The master crooks, I am convinced, were born out of severe cognitive dissonance. Men like Count Ivor Carlack." "Certainly." "Aubrey Dexter, Monsieur Zenith, Huxton Rhymer, Dr. Ferraro." Blake appeared to hesitate. He took a sip of coffee, put the cup aside, and murmured, "Rhymer, no. He and I had a history that was never recounted in the story papers, and which I'm not prepared to speak about now. The others, yes, very dangerous individuals. There were also the organisations, such as the Council of Eleven, and, the most pervasive of them all, the Criminals Confederation," I interjected, "with which you had the longest-running battle of your career." He nodded and examined the bowl of his pipe, which had apparently gone out. In a distracted tone, he said, "My notes pertaining to the Confederation cases were written up by Robert Murray Graydon, the son of William Murray Graydon. Both authors were very loyal to me, but particularly Robert, who managed to make my failures read like victories." I was surprised. Failures? "You've read the stories," he responded. "How many times did the Master Crooks get away scot-free?" Rather reluctantly, I answered, "Most times." "Most times," he echoed. I drank my coffee and watched him as he refilled his pipe, used a small tool to pack in the tobacco, and put a match to it. He puffed and scrutinized me through the pungent smoke. I could hear the rain drumming against the window pane. Nearly a minute passed with no words spoken. Just as I raised my cup to my lips, he said in a quiet tone, "A fourth wave is coming." I swallowed. The cup rattled against the saucer as I put it down. "Pardon?" He took a deep breath and released it slowly through his nostrils. "The first wave of Master Crooks arose during the First World War. The second came just a few years later, during the mid-1920s. The third, minor by comparison, occurred during the late 1950s. A fourth wave is imminent. I recognize the signs." He tapped the binder on his lap with his pipe stem. "It's why I agreed to this. I intend to do exactly as I did before, by using fiction as a means to befuddle my opponents. These anthologies will be the start." "You mean to reassert the legend?" I suggested. "Yes. I suppose you could put it like that." He opened the binder and looked at the issue of Union Jack, the old story paper, that was in the first plastic sleeve. "Is it a good choice?" I asked. "Oh, yes," he said. "Of them all, he was the master crook I admired and respected the most." The Case of the Man in Motley. "Monsieur Zenith the Albino," I said. "I consider him perhaps the most interesting of your criminal foes, from a psychological perspective." "Hmm," he said, leaning back. He put his pipe between his teeth, and his lips made little popping noises as he drew tobacco into his mouth and chugged out the fumes. He gazed over my head, his eyes losing focus. Then he murmured, "Poor Zenith." Taken aback, I cried out, "Poor Zenith? He bombed your house. He tried to kill you and Tinker on countless occasions." With a nonchalant flick of his fingers, Blake dismissed my objection. "Yet he was the criminal with whose motives I could most empathize. The march of history had left him behind. He was an aristocrat of the old school, at a time when such creatures had become all but extinct. Zenith was deprived of his country, his title, his family, and his comrades. He was a fish out of water, an Eastern European raised to occupy a position that, at the very moment it was bestowed, ceased to exist. After that, who could blame him for taking to crime? Not for profit, you understand, but simply for the thrill of it. He was filled with such ennui that he only felt alive when he was defying the law and taking prodigious risks. You've read in the stories how he always carried a poison-laced cigarette. He had every intention of smoking it if he was ever captured without hope of escape. He really didn't care whether he lived or died. I think the author, Anthony Skeen, or George N. Phillips, to use his real name, captured his character superbly. The Case of the Man in Motley by Anthony Skeen, George N. Phillips. Union Jack, issue 844, 1919. The first chapter. Swordplay, The Pallid Man. In a large room at the back of a West End club, a number of men were watching an exposition of the use of the épée, or foiled rapier. Face to face on a narrow strip of fibre matting were two masked and padded figures whose powerful hands were guiding threads of polished steel through the complex and finished ritual of the salute. One was the notorious duelist Monsieur Courtenave, the other Sexton Blake, the famous Baker Street detective, a lover of the épée who rarely found time to indulge his liking for its use. The salute finished, the fencers came to the engage. There was an intense silence in the room. Their weapons crossed with a slight rasping sound, and each sought to read in his opponent's eyes the intention which must be thwarted in the very instant of the act. Then, as though a spell had been broken, the foils flew in and out like a light on a moving sea. Swish, 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 they went. And then one of the fencers lowered his foil and, with a swaggering gesture, touched himself upon the shoulder. It was Monsieur Courtenave.
Touché, he admitted.
The group of watchers, which included Sexton Blake's assistant, Tinker, and their inseparable companion, Pedro, the bloodhound, murmured their applause. It had been a superb thrust in Thiès. But Monsieur Courtenave, who was accounted one of the best fencers outside France, waited pale and silent, pulling at his moustaches furiously. He was not a good loser and wanted revenge.
"If I could only find someone to have a little flutter against the governor," muttered Tinker, who much preferred winning cigarettes to buying them. "Honoured, sir," whispered a voice by his side, "I will have gladness to make a wager with you."
Turning, astonished, Tinker found a shrewd-looking Japanese at his side.
"My hat," he exclaimed. "You're not a thought reader, are you?"
"Thought reader? How?
I not understand," jerked the man.
Then he went on.
"The wager. How shall we say? My cigarette case against the cigarette case of honoured sir that Mr. Blake is touched at the next bout."
"Done," said Tinker.
The other's cigarette case was painted wood, while Tinker's own case was of silver, but the lad knew that he was getting something more than evens against his master. He was something of a connoisseur, and he perceived that the wooden cigarette case was almost priceless. The English lad and the short Japanese stood side by side when the foils engaged again. As before, there was a tense minute of silence, a rapid slashing of steel against steel, and a murmur of applause as one of the combatants gave the signal of defeat. And once more, it was Monsieur Courtenave, who brought his foil to the salute, touching himself upon the breast where the buttoned end of the weapon had stabbed his quilted coat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.